All right, we're live again this week. This time, we are pleased to have Isaac Abraham, who is an F-sharp MVP and a .NET developer since .NET 1.0, with an interest in cloud computing and distributed data problems. He nowadays lives in both the UK and Germany, and is the director of Compositional IT. He specializes in consultancy, training, and development, helping customers adopt high-quality, functional-first solutions on the .NET platform. And today, he'll be talking about F-sharp, Azure, and the web, the best of friends. Isaac, thank you for joining us. We look forward to what you have to say. If you have questions, please use the box of boxes toggle to switch to the Q&A feature and ask your questions there, or also on Twitter at C for F Sharp. And Isaac, it doesn't look like you're muted, but I can't hear you right now. Since we have some audio problems, I was just speaking with Isaac, so I know it's working, or was working. Give us just a minute to sort this out, and I think we'll be getting started shortly. All right, well, Isaac is rejoining. For those of you who are interested in asking questions, I imagine this will be a good one to ask questions for. Please enter your questions in the Q&A box. Again, there's a box of boxes you can use to switch to the Q&A mode, and we'll be monitoring and asking those questions as we go along.
Hi, guys. Can you hear me now?
Yes, loud and clear. Thank you, Isaac.
Excellent. Sorry about that. I guess hopefully that was my demo demon for the evening, but we'll see. So yeah, thanks for the introduction, Ryan. Much appreciated. Really excited to be here. So I think what I'll be doing is I'll share my screen now. Actually, so let's move to there and quickly over to this guy. So I'm hoping you can see the FS Reveal PowerPoint in front of you presentation.
Yes.
Good. Okay. So what I'll just do is speak a little bit, maybe 5-10 minutes. I'll try and keep it to a minimum, just to give an overview of what I'm hoping to go through today, and then the rest will be demos and code focused, really, and we'll look at some Azure things as well. As Ryan said before, please, if you're listening now, just jump in and ask questions throughout. Ryan will forward them on to me. Let's just get as many questions as we can. If you've got any questions, then happy to go through it as we go through the presentation. So I just want to start by just a little bit about me, my background, and why I sort of are using Azure and F-sharp. And then we'll sort of compare and contrast these three different sort of horizontal tiers, really, and how they fit in with one another. Just a brief a bit about me. Ryan's already given me an introduction. That's the first picture I saw on Google when I looked up my name. But yeah, as Ryan said, I'm based in Germany now and in the UK. I sort of travel between both countries. I've been an F-sharp dev since 2012, and I'm an MVP in F-sharp. Although we don't really have F-sharp MVPs anymore now. It's mostly just .NET MVPs. Just so that I'll put this whole slide deck online, but feel free to email me, catch me on Twitter, go to my website, my blog, any questions you've got later on. Always happy to talk about this sort of stuff. So the three things I'm really going to talk about over the next hour is firstly F-sharp, why I use that in isolation, irrespective of Azure and the web. Two, why I use Azure and cloud in general. There's a lot of sort of buzzwords around cloud computing and in cloud in general. I'm hoping to show you some practical examples of how we can use it today. And then thirdly, about web development. And I guess when I'm talking about web development at the moment, I'm not necessarily referring to client-side scripts only. I'm talking more about web-facing applications, APIs that are scalable, that need to be REST compliant, for example, and things like that. So that the whole end-to-end, really, of what we think of web apps. So I'll start with just a brief talk about F-sharp in general. A lot of customers of mine and friends of mine that don't necessarily use F-sharp often ask, why would I use F-sharp over C-sharp or VB or Java, for example? I'm assuming that in the meetup tonight are a mix of people that have got F-sharp experience and some that don't. So, and the same for Azure as well. So I'm hoping that there'll be something in this presentation for everyone, really. F-sharp is a really powerful language, but it's a general purpose language. So just like in C-sharp, you can use it for all sorts of applications. The same applies to F-sharp. I think somewhat unfortunately, it's got a bit of a reputation for being suitable for mathematics and science only. Nothing could be further from the truth, really. You can do web development in it. You can do Windows applications, services. Line of business applications. It's a really great language. The nice thing about it is that the compiler is really powerful. There's a lot of work for us, so we can concentrate on the real business value that we're developing rather than a lot of the boilerplate. I've found over the last few years that I get less bugs in F-sharp. I used to be an absolute TDD fanatic, and I've completely gone the other way now. I write unit tests, but they don't become the focus of my application development sort of life cycle now. I've learned to trust the compiler in F-sharp a lot more, which means that I can develop software a lot more quickly than I used to be able to do. It's got a really lightweight syntax. So just as an example, and I know that the top example is probably a little bit shorter now in C-sharp 6. But nonetheless, F-sharp is an extremely sort of succinct language. It lets you focus on the real core. So if you look at the example at the bottom there, this record type gives us a full constructor, it gives us immutable properties, it gives us structural equality for every field, all of this out of the box. So very, very easy to read and understand. Also very, very nice for sort of domain modeling. So for an example here, if I wanted to model the weather, I might say, well, there's four different types, sunny, raining, snowing, windy. And you'll see that, for example, snowing has a bit of metadata we've attached to it, which is the actual snowfall. And you'll also see that we can attach things called units of measure in F-sharp. So I can say here, the snowfall is X number of meters per hour or centimeters per hour. And for example, if it's windy, not only do I want to capture the wind speed, but also the direction, which is one of four different cases. This sort of code you might do in C-sharp through, for example, object hierarchies and inheritance. Here I've done the entire model in just a few lines of code, so very succinct and easy to understand. It's also got fantastic data access capabilities. So here's an example from a library called F-sharp data, which allows us to parse JSON data from any particular API. So you can see here I'm actually pointing to a URL called Open Weather Map. I can simply hit load, and then I get full IntelliSense for all of the data that's been returned without the need to generate a set of DTOs in advance. So it's really, really easy to get up and running with arbitrary data sets, whether they're JSON, XML, CSV, or any number of formats very, very quickly. It's also got great support for asynchronous workflow. So if you've used C#, you'll be familiar with async await. Well, that's actually based on async in F#, which was, as far as I'm aware, the first language to really try and do something like this. In F#, we really have this let bang rather than async await. What's very nice is that we can reason about this quite easily. It's essentially anything in this async block will be executed asynchronously. And if I highlight over the variable that it's been assigned to, the value, we'll see from the tooltip that it's an async of integer. You can think of this like a task of int. And this is pervasive in the language. The nice thing is that async workflows are simply one type of workflow. We can create as many of these as we want. Overall, I would say, just to summarize on the F-sharp side of things, one of the sort of mantras of the language is it lets you solve complex problems with simple code. At the same time, don't think that you can only use F-sharp to solve complex problems. You can also use it to solve simple problems with even simpler code. So it's a general purpose language that's just particularly well suited, I think, for writing scalable applications for dealing with data. So move on. Just talk a little bit about the web and F#. I think often, as I said before, we tend not to think of maybe F# as a language for the web. But again, I'd say that's not necessarily true. You can think of typical server-side web applications that need to have a number of different sort of behaviors. They're normally stateless. Well, we're in luck because in F#, by default, as a functional first language, everything is immutable by default. So it generally leads you down the path of working in a stateless manner anyway. Server-side web apps also tend to be very data-oriented. F# is particularly good at working with data, so another good fit. We need to write apps that are fault tolerant normally. And although we'll see also with Azure how that helps us, F# is very good at reasoning about data, about reasoning about errors, writing code that we can handle different cases, for example, nulls, help us a lot. And we've also seen things like asynchronicity that I've just shown you. F# works really well with this. You can write extremely complex workflows by simply plugging together simple components and simple functions to build up more complicated workflows. The front-end website is actually pretty good on F# at the moment. There are a number of different libraries and frameworks out there that give us this sort of cross-compiling facility. So this is an example of the Fable library that's recently been released. And there's actually a website that allows you to write F# on one side and you'll see the JavaScript on the right, sort of like how TypeScript's website does it. There are a number of other libraries as well, like FunScript, and there's also a framework called WebSharper that lets you write complete end-to-end applications completely in F#, reactive applications. It'll handle all the RPC client-server callbacks for you. You basically don't even notice that you're doing the writing client-side code. I'm not actually going to focus too much on that. In fact, I'm not going to focus anything on the client side today. It's mostly on the back end. But there is actually a good story for the front end as well in F#. What I am going to focus on today when I talk about server-side is really the two frameworks at the top here. So if you're a C# dev, you've almost certainly seen ASP.NET before and Web API. So I'm going to show you how we can get that working in F# very, very easily. And then we'll look at another framework called Suave, which is a functional first F# framework and library. There is another one called Freya that, I'm not going to talk about simply because I've not actually used it. But there are a number of different options here that allow us to do web programming very, very easily. Lastly, before I jump into the actual demos, we'll just talk a little bit about the cloud and Azure. I think there's a lot of hype around it, obviously, with good reason. But there's also a lot of misinformation about it. So we sort of had this promise of the cloud a number of years ago, and we're finally at the point where I think it is actually quite possible to realize these sorts of things. So, you know, the idea of the cloud is you lower your costs. You don't have to spend a lot of money on hardware up front. You simply pay as you go for different hardware and services as you need it from the cloud. It allows us ideally to reduce our time to market by, rather than spending a lot of time on infrastructure, we can simply rent that infrastructure or services from Azure or AWS, for example. And they also opened up a lot of new possibilities for writing types of apps that you probably wouldn't have normally done in the past with an on-premise solution. So think about distributed applications that are quite difficult to do normally. A cloud does actually make that quite a lot easier. I want to spend a little bit of time now talking about pizzas. So there's this sort of idea of the cloud is sort of a one side and you've got your on-premise on the other side. And actually, there are a number of different ways you can actually go about starting to use the cloud. So on the left, if you consider pizza as a service, if you went to the shop and bought all the ingredients yourself, you do the whole thing from scratch. You have to put all the toppings on, the cheese, put it in the oven, you get the drinks, you get the dining table, and you clear up at the end. And if we move to the next level, which is infrastructure as a service, you can think of that as you've gone to the shop, you've bought the pizza in the package, you've gone home and put it in the oven. So half of it is sort of done for you, but you still got to do some of it yourself. The next level is what we call platform as a service, which takes us much higher up the stack, where you can think of this as you've gone and actually ordered a pizza to be delivered to your house. In this case, actually, you don't have to worry about anything up to the cooking. All you've got to do is put it on the table, get a drink and eat. And the final one is software as a service, which is the whole thing. You go to the shop, you pay a little bit of a premium, but everything is done for you. You don't have to worry about cleaning up at the end. You don't have to worry about laying the table at the start. And this parallel, this actually matches quite nicely with a lot of services in Azure and in the cloud in general. So you can think of on-premise as managing the entire stack yourself. And then as you move to the right, we deal with less and less. So infrastructure as a service, you can think of as having a virtual machine, basically. Platform services will typically be application level services, and then software services are actually applications in the cloud. As developers, we're probably most interested in the platform service, or PaaS. So these are services that allow us to write applications much more quickly without actually focusing, and allow us to focus on the business domain rather than the boilerplate of actually writing these services ourselves. I'll give you an example of a few of these services now. Once we look at some of these challenges that we face, so looking at the cloud, you have a number of new challenges that you probably didn't have to deal with when you were looking at on-premise software development. Things like deployment. You can't just walk up to a machine now with a USB stick and copy some code on. You have to come up with a way of deploying code in a repeatable manner that pushes into a service that exists ideally. You have to worry about resiliency in the cloud. Things just get turned off, frankly. You are not in control of your machine. AWS or Azure or Google can simply turn off a service and move it to another machine. You have to basically write software to cope with this. We have to deal with different programming models. I mentioned before about distributed applications. It's a very different way of working. And lastly, just about abstracting, writing abstractions that allow us to write code as we normally would without having to worry as much as possible about these sorts of issues about distributed applications. So we can think of things like messaging. We need to communicate between different applications or different processes. How do we do that? So a number of these services live on both AWS and Azure, for example, distributed queues. So you can communicate from one machine or one application to another through a queue. Now the queue is just a service. It gives you an endpoint and you can simply won't lose the message. And it will guarantee that this message has been processed at least once, for example. You also have event systems that can handle sort of pub/sub sort of mechanisms as well and scale really, really easily. We've got sort of storage. So for blobs, which are essentially just files, blobs of data, maybe tables, or maybe even SQL, so relational models. All of these services, again, can be turned on really, really quickly and easily, and we can scale them out based on demand. So a very different model to what you might be used to working with sort of an on-premise system where you buy a particular machine and you have to scale it up. And there are a number of different compute options as well. So reactive applications that maybe you have some code that will get launched every time a message is put onto a queue. Web applications, which is what we're going to focus on today. Services, so more like Windows services, but running in the cloud, all the way through to microservices and containers like Docker, and even virtual machines, which is sort of the lowest level, I would suggest. So F# on Azure, just want to do a bit of information. I think Azure, when it first came out, certainly was a very Windows-centric and .NET-centric framework and platform. And over the last year or two, they've really changed that. Azure is very much open source and non-Windows-centric nowadays. A lot of services are JavaScript first. They support Python, Java. There's APIs for most of these services and not all of them across many languages now. And F# is actually, as a .NET language, essentially any service that already works with C#, you can pretty much get it to work with F#. Some of them will work straight out of the box. Some of them you have to maybe do a tiny bit of work. But generally, every Azure service that you see today can be used within F#. You might not have all the docs online, but as long as you can do a translation from C# to F#, then you're pretty much good to go. So with that in mind, I'll actually move over to the demo today. And and the actual code that I'm going to talk about. So I'm going to show you a quick website that I've knocked up. And this is actually publicly hosted now on Azure, so you guys can look at this URL now if you want. And it's just a demonstrator that I've been using and I'm basically building up with some more examples. So this is a simple example that shows a web application that is basically pulling some data back through a web API that is hosted in Azure. And it shows it in a TypeScript and AngularJS application. Before I actually go any further, are there any questions so far, Ryan, or still good to go?
Still good to go so far.
Okay, cool. So this is actually an application that's client-side in the JS. It's a pretty simple app. On the back end is an F-sharp web service that's basically feeding data into this. What's interesting is more about how this application is getting its data, where it's coming from, and how it works. So I can basically say, pick me a particular month, get all the football results up until that time, and then build me up the league table based on all of those results thus far. And you'll see that as I pick different months, then the table obviously updates. So very nice. So the question is, where am I getting all this data from? So the answer is actually, I'm actually using another website to feed me the data. I don't actually store it locally. So there's a website on Yahoo, which actually has all this data as just an HTML table. And every time we hit my API, it will go off to this one, pull down the results, and actually do an accumulation to build up our table. So we don't actually store this league table anywhere on disk. We only actually use this website as a source of the lowest level of data, and then we pull it up into a table. So slightly different way of working, maybe.
All right, hold on, everyone. Let me see if I can get Isaac back online. Oh, there he is. Everything all right?
Ryan, have you got my audio back again? Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you again.
No? Yes? Okay, great. Excellent. Probably just the interwebs there. Stopping me for a minute, but looks like we're good to go again. Sorry about that. And that was just the part we're getting to the fun now. So what I'll just do is take you through this application now.
You'll need to reshare your screen again.
All right, you've lost the sharing as well. Okay, cool. So screen share, entire screen. Share. Is that working okay?
Yes, looks good. Thank you very much.
Good. No, sorry about that. No worries. Okay, so let's dive into some code now. So we've got this solution. It's got three projects. And I'm just going to focus on this core one, which is this football library. So at the very top, I have just a couple of domain types that are basically going to be used to expose to our web APIs later on. Just plain F-sharp records, nothing more than that. And essentially, the API has a very simple mechanism. Now, if you've not used F-sharp before, this is just Visual Studio. And on the left, I've got my code, which is actually a script file. What the script file allows me to do is execute arbitrary bits of code from my project without having to run up a console test harness. And I can see the results straight away in my F-sharp interactive. So I can highlight this code and hit Alt-Enter, and it actually executes all of that code. So all it's done at the moment is just added in a few references. I've also used.
Would you mind increasing the font size just a bit? We just had a question.
Yeah, of course. Is that any better?
Yeah, that looks a lot better. Thank you.
Okay, No worries. I'll also increase the size of the interactive window. So let's just go to fonts, F-sharp interactive, and we'll increase that to 15. Okay, great. So what I can do here is actually call my application and actually test it from within the script. Now, this is a really useful way of exploring my application, for developing it slowly, step by step, and then adding more and more into it as I go through it. As an aside, if you're using F-sharp already, there's an excellent extension you should use called the F-sharp Power Tools, which gives us a whole host of things such as improved colorization, it gives us refactorings, and it also generates a load of scripts for us to automatically load an entire project as a script for me, so I don't have to manually reference all of the dependencies myself. So that's what the script at the very top is doing for us. So what I'm going to do is just call into my code to call this API called get results for month. And what that says is, for a particular month, get me all of the results from that Yahoo website. So if I just F12 into it, we'll just look at what it does. And it's pretty simple, actually. All I do is pass in this enum, and I build up the date and the month. So if we go back to the browser, we'll see that at the top here, we have to pass in the particular month and the particular year. So that's all I'm essentially doing. And then I can go off to this URL and insert my month and year, and I can get the results back. And then immediately I get a list of all the tables with IntelliSense, because I'm using the HTML type provider, which parses the HTML and gives me back all of the tables in there. I just call those first two lines. Right here, we should actually see, after a short delay, I've got my data back. It's a bit unwieldy at the moment, so what I'm just going to do is put it into a data frame, just so it's a bit more easily readable. And you can see now we have all of the columns taken from the table directly. Problem is, obviously, you can see here that there are a number of rows here that actually aren't results. So this one has some dates in it, this one is blanks, and so on. How do we remove all this data and cleanse it up a bit? So the HTML type provider has done a lot of the work for us, but it can't do everything. So we need a number of sort of simple rules to filter out our data. This is where F-sharp comes in really handy, is that it's really good at building up small bits of functionality and composing them into larger ones. So I've built up a number of rules here. So for example, I've got, is it a blank row? Well, if it's a blank row, then the away column is an empty string. Or is it currently playing game? And if it is, then the away row will contain the word live. And if it's a date row, it will have a comma in it. If it's in the future, it will have the text VS and so on. And then I can simply build all of those rules into one bigger rule. So here I've said, well, it can't be a blank row. It can't be a date row. It can't be in the future. And then reduce them. So the output of this is valid row is actually a function that takes in a single row and gives me back a true or false. And it will simply iterate through all of these rules. So I can then push that up using the array filter function, which is just like dot where if you use the link. Now when I run this again, we'll see that we actually then trim out all of the invalid results, and we just get the valid results now. Super. And the last thing we need to do is build it into this table, this leak table. So what that does is go into a function which essentially will take the result, trim out some of the or pass some of the data in it, so pull out the home team and the away team. And then I've written a very simple function here called record score. And all that the home and the away score, and essentially says, for the current result, add on an extra value onto it. So if played was one, then played should be two now. If they had one win before and they've won this game, then add on another value, and so on and so forth. And once we've done this simple function, we can then use the fold function, which is a general sort of aggregation function, to actually build that into a full table. So if I run the whole function now, we'll see it's cool. We actually get a leak table, which has just accumulated all of those results. Well, get an exception there. Where has occurred? Key was not present in the dictionary. Try that again. There we go. So here you can see we've got the actual results, and all I'll just do is quickly pull out the second half of it. list. Second. Shouldn't have a full table. There we go. Those are all the games that have been played and so on and so forth. So that's sort of our API in the background. The question is, how do we surface that or start to surface that over the web, really? Before I talk about that, I just want to give you a couple more examples of some of the things we can do in F# quite easily and how they're useful within the context of a high-performance application. So one of them is caching. So obviously, we can use our website to cache data on the client side, but what about every time I hit this Yahoo website? We don't want to be going back to that every time, so we want to cache that quite easily. And it's lucky that F# actually is really good at something like this. So to build a cache layer is actually just 4 or 5 lines of code. It just says pass in the code that you want to run, and then every time I get an argument, I'll check if I've ever run this code with the input arguments. If I have, I'll return the values. If I haven't, then I'll call the real code and then give you the result back. So just to illustrate that, here's a simple function called add, which takes two numbers and adds them together. If I pass that function into my memoizer or my cache layer, every time I call add now, the first time it's called our printfn function. But every time subsequently I call it now, you'll see that we just get cache hit because it's actually going through this code and I've actually stored in my dictionary that exact result. So I don't have to call it again every time. So we can actually use this same principle within our application. So if we go back to my code and I scroll down a bit, you'll see I've just basically plugged into this code. I've wrapped it in this memoize guy. And this is a slightly more complicated version of what you just saw. But essentially, it says cache this value for 30 seconds. And the name of the cache is results for year. And that way, if I get 20 requests at the same time, the first one will obviously go to the real URI, but the rest of them will just use the in-memory cache. In a bigger application, a cloud context, you might not obviously put this in memory. You might elect to use something like Redis or Blob Storage to cache these results and then get them out very, very quickly. One of the things I've done is actually added an event that whenever we get a cache in my application, I can then subscribe to an event. So I'll just add into that event and then call my code again. So let's call this guy September. When we run this the first time, you'll see it takes a couple of seconds to get all the results. But if I run it a second time, you'll see it comes back immediately and we get our cache hits. And if I run it for, say, October now, well, we've cached August and September. We only have to get the October month. So you can see we get 2 cache hits, a small delay, and then the rest of the results. So I want to just now show you quickly how we can plug this sort of code base into a website. So the first thing I'll do is show you ASP.NET MVC. Very, very easy to do with the Owen host sort of framework that's come out quite recently, which doesn't rely on all of the code gen that the earlier versions of web API needed. So all I've done is created a class library, and there's actually a template for this already in Visual Studio. If you go to tools and I think it's probably file new project, and you can look at some of the templates that are available online. If you look around enough, you'll find there's one for the web, which is called F# ASP.NET MVC 5 and Web API. From there, that will give you a whole host of templates for F# ready projects. They really don't do a great deal in terms of the code they emit. There's not a lot of code gen. Just sets up a few things to make it a little bit easier for you. But all I have in here is actually quite simple, really. We have a startup class, which is basically takes in what's called an IAP builder. And this is just an Owen IAP builder. So it's just using the standard global Owen framework and system web HTTP. So if we look at the dependencies in this project, you'll see they're just a few of them. And they're all really Microsoft Owen and the standard Owen libraries. It's nothing really F# specific there. And I create a configuration. And then what I'm going to do is remove the XML formatter so that our results come in JSON. And then the one thing I have to do is to change the contract resolver to use what's called the default contract resolver. What this does is it tells ASP.NET how to serialize our types when they're going over the web. And in this case, it's going to help us serialize our F-sharp record type. So when we go back to our code here and we look at our contracts, these guys will be serialized exactly as this. There won't be any issues with that. And then we just set up a default route. Then when we look at our controllers, it's actually really, really easy. This is a class in F-sharp. It inherits from API controller and it has a method called get. And the ID is going to be pushed into our get league method, which you saw just before. And we're going to return that as a task. That's pretty much everything we need to do to wrap our entire application into ASP.NET. Don't have to do anything more than that. We can do the same for a second controller. Of course, in here, you've noticed that I've not actually added a separate class file for every one. They're just three-line classes. As far as I'm concerned, there's no need to really add a separate file for every one of these. But there's really not a lot of boilerplate there. It's quite easy. What I'd like to do now is talk about the Suave framework, which is an F-sharp framework. Has anyone got any questions at this point on the web API side of things?
No one has asked any questions, but John Azariah on Twitter mentioned that people should be joining to listen to your silvery baritone voice.
Yes, with my my English gentleman accent, yeah. Moving on then. I'm just going to show you essentially to do the exact same thing that we just saw using the Suave framework and a little bit more. So Suave is a very nice framework for F-sharp. In that it's purely functional. We don't use classes as such. And it's an entirely asynchronous framework as well, which is also pretty nice. So all we really need is the Suave dependency, and the rest will come down for us. It'll bring down any of its sub-dependencies. Suave is just a console app. So it just starts with a main method. If I scroll down here, you'll see it's just the main guy. It takes in two arguments, in my case, which is the port I'm going to run on and where I'm going to host the static files. So you saw earlier on that this was not just an API, it's a full-featured website. So obviously, we need to push out our front-end content with this application. Web API doesn't have great support for that. So if you look, what I've done is actually cheated. In the web host folder, I've actually put the client-side assets directly alongside the project so that they all get pushed out as one. Suave is actually a bit better than that in that we can actually tell it where to look for files. So it can act as a file server over the web, as well as an API layer, all in one. Now, with Web API, we had a set of controllers that we used with the routing. In Suave, it's very different. We actually have a set of routes that are really just a set of questions. Is this the route? Is the route that's been passed in one that I can handle? So, for example, here we have: is it a GET request? If it is, then we'll try one of these. If it's not a GET request, or it's a get and none of these passed, then we're going to return 404. So it's just almost like an if-then statement. And then within the get, we say, right, well, did the URL match this route? If it did, then we're going to call our getLeak function and return it as JSON. And we'll do that asynchronously. We've got a couple of other routes there. I've got one here that says if you go to the thrown exception route, then we're going to fail with an exception. And if it's none of those ones, then we'll simply go to the index.htm. So very, very easy to set up an entire routing structure. And of course, this is entirely composable. So we could have more complicated routes in a separate function or a separate module and just bring them up here. But everything sort of comes down very easy to reason about in terms of it's just a list with a set of predicates almost. If this route passes, go onto my code. So if I run this locally, and to do that, I'll have to turn off my PowerPoint. So this code builds, and we can see we've started up our endpoint. And then if I go over to that, so let's go to localhost 83. See, there's our website's loaded. And if I pop back to Suave, you'll see all the requests are going through there. So everything has gone through there. And if I pick a different API endpoint or a different request, you'll see there's the second request we've made. So even just at this point, you can see that we've sort of merged in TypeScript and JavaScript and AngularJS very nicely on one side, and we're using F# for the web requests, essentially, for all the data-intensive bits. And if I look at the actual request, I'll actually switch to, see if we can do it from here. So if I refresh this guy, see if we get a particular request network. There, you can see the results there. It's just plain JSON, and we can drill into that. And that matches exactly the F# record types that we had before. So we didn't actually have to design our F# application to be web ready. It's just actually very, very easy to do. So we get all the power of F# with the type inference and everything when we're in F# world, and then we split out JSON, and then any web application can use that, or another application indeed. So got about 20, 25 minutes left. What I'm going to do is just move over to talk a bit about Azure now, and how cloud can help us here. So we've written this application locally. How do we actually start sharing that with other people? Because, you know, everyone wants to use an application that can show the league table, obviously. So I'm going to switch into the Azure portal here, where I've already signed in, and just show you how this works. So essentially what we can do with Azure is I can create any number of resources. I can do this in the portal, which is where I am now, or we can do this from a declarative JSON. Yep.
Would it be possible to zoom in a little bit in the browser just to make sure that the text is
Yeah, sure. Is that reasonable?
That's excellent. Yes, thank you very much.
Yep, great. Okay, good. So we can see here, we can create all manner of different types of services, from virtual machines to websites to storage accounts, basically all the things I was telling you about earlier. We can also do this in a repeatable manner with what's called a resource manager template, which is a JSON template that maintains the structure of your application. So it might be, I've got an app that has a storage account and a SQL database and a website, and go and deploy it. And it can do this in a repeatable manner. So it's not all driven by a website only. You can do all of this through an API, which is quite nice. So anyway, I've logged into my dashboard, and I can see my web app here that I've created earlier. So what can I do with this website? So straight away out of the box, we get a URL that we can see the app, and I get some metrics on it down here. So let me get rid of this Essentials tab. So we get things like the number of HTTP requests we get, if we got any server errors, how many requests, and so on and so forth. And I can drill into that if I want to as well. So I can see exactly how many I've received and the average of them, and so on and so forth. This all happens out of the box when I've deployed my application into Azure. There's nothing I need to do particularly to do that. The question is, how do we get a Suave console app into this web app sort of service? So Azure web apps are designed to run primarily in IIS. It's basically IIS as a service. So you can create a normal ASP.NET website and deploy it out of the box, essentially. How do you do a Suave application that is AF#, well, okay, but it's also a console app. So it turns out that IIS actually has some reasonable support for doing something just like this. What we have to do is add a web config file, even though this is a console app, and we simply add a couple of lines here to remove the default HTTP handler. And what we do is essentially say we're actually going to redirect traffic to this application, my Suave host XE, which is the name of my project, and it will take in two arguments, which is the port number and the current location where we are. So if you remember, the program file takes in two arguments, port and where our static files are. So that's those two arguments there. Once we've done that, as soon as we deploy our code, ASP.NET or IIS will actually launch our executable and then redirect all traffic over that port, which Suave is listening to. That's everything we need to do. So we've sort of talked about now, how do we match between an executable and IIS or Azure websites? How do we actually deploy the code into that? And there are a load of different options there. So we can do it over FTP, we can do it over HTTP, we can upload files, we can do it in the portal. The easiest way to do it, though, actually, is through source control. So websites in Azure have a number of different really useful features. I'll talk through some of them now. One of them is called deployments sources. So if I look here and I look at my deployment source, I've actually hooked it up to source control. So you can use Bitbucket, you can use GitHub, you can use TFS. There's all sorts of different mechanisms which we can pull code in. And essentially, anytime I do a push to the particular branch I've configured, it will automatically download that source and run a build. And that build can be whatever code I need. So that could be a fake script if you come from F#. In my case, it's a really simple build, and I'll just show you what that build scripts looks like. Let's have a look at build.command. So if we ignore the top bit, which is auto-generated for us, the key bits are really here. I'm using Packet as my dependency manager, so I'm just going to call Packet Bootstrapper to download the real Packet app. Then I'm going to use Packet Restore to restore my NuGet dependencies. Then I'm going to copy, using xcopy, the static content, so the website for all of my JavaScript and TypeScript and so on and so forth, the HTML. The web job will leave for now. Don't worry about that. The key bit here is what I'm going to call msbuild. So I'm going to actually build my website as part of my deployment process. Once that's done, I'm going to use this tool called Kudu, which is part of Azure Websites, which does a diff between what I've just built and what is running on the website. And any files that have changed, it will automatically copy across. And any files that are no longer needed, it will remove for me. So it does the sort of the synchronization for me. And if I go back to the deployments and I click on any one of these, you'll see we can see the log of everything happened. So this deploy took only 16 seconds. So from the moment I actually committed into GitHub, it's taken, or Bitbucket in my case, it's taken 16 seconds for it to download the code, run the build, and actually push out any changes. And I can then view the log. And we'll see here it's done checking Packet, downloading the application, and doing a synchronization having done an MS build. So it does a full build. It does everything that I would want to do in a CI service, essentially. Plus, it will actually deploy the code onto a website. So super useful and really easy. Azure websites also give us a load of other features that you would want in any website out of the box. So for example, it gives us detailed logs as things are going on. So I've turned on logging here, and we'll show you that in a minute. It gives us authorization and auth out of the box. So for example, here, if I turn on the app service, I can literally just say, right, from now on, I want my app service to be AD, use Azure Active Directory to take requests. I'll be forced then to log in and pass in my token to my application before I can actually use it. This is sort of stuff out of the box. You just flick a switch and you've got auth, basically. Also has a number of other features, such as deployment slots. So imagine you've got a website and you want to push a new version out, but you're not sure if it works or not, for example, and maybe you want to be able to roll back very easily. Azure has this notion of deployment slots where you can create the live one and a beta version and so on. You push your code out, it gets deployed to the secondary slot. When you're happy with that, you simply hit flip, and instantly all the main traffic, will, instead of going to the live site, will go to the other one. And you can have up to 8 slots at once, so you can have 8 different versions of the app running at any given time. So it's really, really easy to do sort of a staged environment, make sure your app's working, and then actually push it out. Of course, we also have things like scale up and scale out that I sort of touched on before. So I can go to my app and basically choose from any number of these different deployment plans, service plans. So the cheapest one is completely free. What that essentially says is you live on shared infrastructure. So your website will be shared with other websites on the same machine. And obviously, you have a finite amount of resources that you can do. And you can go all the way up to single machines that have one core, all the way up to 4-core machines with 7 gigs of RAM and have all sorts of different things in them. You can simply click a switch, and within about half a minute, your app will automatically resize. So super useful if you've got an app that suddenly gets a bit more traffic. But you also need to scale out, because everyone says on the cloud you need to scale out. What this really means is I get a slider here, and I can simply drag that and say I want 7 instances of my website. Go. You hit save up here, and immediately you will get 7 instances of this website. You can also use what's called the autoscaler. So I can do it based on, for example, CPU percentage. So I can say if CPU percentage hits more than X is between this and this percentage, then scale up between 2 and 7 websites. And as my CPU utilization across the pool essentially rises or declines, the number of instances as well will work. So this is great if you've got like seasonal traffic, or maybe at certain hours of the day you have lots of traffic on your app and not so much on another one. Really, really useful. Of course, you can do the usual things such as look at config settings. You can change app config settings and so on and so forth. And we can see IP addresses and whatnot. I'll also show you and briefly just some of the logging things here. So for example, we can look at audit logs to show me things that have happened, like an update of a website happened 7 hours ago. And if I go down to diagnostic logs, actually look at on the website. If I go to tools, we can see actually a number of things here. So I can actually look at the log stream. So these are all the logs that are actually being sent out from the web application right now. So if I go to the website and actually start viewing my site, because Suave emits everything to the console, we'll suddenly start to see hopefully things out here actually coming on to Azure. So you can see there's some pages being sent out and so on and so forth. But essentially all the, there's a 404 I've got there. Everything is being pushed out now to this logs. And we can even do things like remote debugging with ASP.NET applications very, very easily. But it becomes sort of a single portal. And I can even actually log into the machine if I want to. So I can hit console. And then actually I'm actually remoted onto the actual machine now. And I can actually start to actually do directory listings and so on and so forth. So essentially for a website, this is everything you really need to do any sort of web-facing application. We can even set up things like alerts as well. So I can say set up an alert for this website that if my if I get more than 5 HTTP 404s in the last 5 minutes, send me an email. Or call an HTTP endpoint as a webhook. So you can imagine almost a reactive application that if it starts getting errors, it will actually send itself messages or send to another application that can actually respond to that and do something with it.
Isaac has a question.
Yep.
Does this all work for web jobs as well, since that also resides in the app service area?
Yes, great question. So web jobs live within websites as well. So in terms of requests, they don't actually fit within the web jobs themselves. So just in case you don't know what a web job is, a web job is a really nice part of websites, which is essentially, imagine you've got a SQL database backing a website and you want some query results showing in a find screen. A web job can be used to run on a regular basis to pre-generate some data for you, for example. So you can do that based on a schedule, or you can do that based on a queue message being put into the application and so on and so forth. They sort of live outside of the app though, so the alerts and so on don't fit into the metrics, but there is a way that you can do alerts through web jobs that I'll show you in just a minute. It's actually a good question. It's a good question to ask though, because actually, what is a web job really? A web job is just an executable that gets fired on a predefined schedule. As it turns out, web jobs, although a lot of people don't actually realize this, you can actually use F# scripts as a web job. So if I switch back here, you'll see I've got a solution item called sample.fsx, which is just an F# script. Doesn't do anything more than that. There's no executables, it's just an FSX file. If you deploy this as part of your solution, it will automatically go as a web job. So if I go back into my application and go to tool settings, I believe, and then scroll down to web jobs, you'll see there's my sample web job, and I can click that, and I've set it to run on a schedule every half a minute. So all this web job does is a really simple script. It writes out hello from web job with the current date time, and it just writes it to the local file system. So obviously a real web job might be doing something such as updating a SQL database. It might be checking data on log files. It can be doing anything on a regular basis, really.
And what's and the... Sorry, so you said if you include this in your deployment, in what way do you need to include it? Is it in a folder or in a
So as long as it's included at the within the folder structure, if it's separate from the actual website, it will automatically get picked up. So I'll actually show you that. If you look at the, I'll actually go, you basically have to copy it to the web jobs folder. So if I go back to the that build f command file, it's a good question. You'll see here where I skipped over this before. There you go. You essentially copy it to a folder called continuous and then the name of the web job. So that's all I've done there. There's actually an HTTP endpoint that you can actually upload a script to, though, which is essentially the name of your website dot something like scmwebsites.azure.net. And you upload your scripts in there, and it will automatically upload and create the web job for you. So you can do this outside of the CI process as well. And if I actually go back to the tools and go back to the console, and I'm doing ls, you'll see there's the sample.txt. And you'll see there, then half a minute ago was when we last spat out this web job. So you can literally just deploy F# scripts into a web job and they will just work. It uses FSI behind the scenes to actually launch FSX, the FSX file. So really, really easy. There's also a really nice SDK on top of web jobs that allows you to do reactive programming. So when queue messages get onto a queue or service bus or essentially web jobs can essentially respond to any of those almost in a reactive manner. So you give it a function and it will handle that for you. Very, very nice. We've got about 10 minutes, which is about good. I want to show you a bit more, though, about how we can understand our app's behavior from the cloud. So the biggest issue you will have when you deploy an application is, what is it doing? I've shown you, obviously, a little bit about what is it doing in terms of HTTP errors and requests per second and CPU usage, but it doesn't really tell me much more about that in terms of the application. So there's another service in Azure called App Insights, which is essentially a logging and tracing framework for .NET. Well, not even for .NET, I should say. It's for Azure. And it works with JavaScript apps. It works with PHP. It works with Java. It works with .NET. And I've actually plugged it into Suave. And it's really, really easy to do. Essentially, I've got a couple of helper classes, a couple of helper methods that do all the work. And what this one does here is we essentially start at the top with this guy called a telemetry client. And a telemetry client is essentially our hook into App Insights. It's where we send messages onto it. So you'll see if we look at the client, we have methods on it such as start an operation, stop an operation, track a particular event that happened in the app, and so on. What I do is every time a request comes through, I say start an operation. So this essentially says start a particular request, start timing it, and that's the URL for this request. And then I execute the web part. And then when it's completed, I append onto this telemetry object the URL, the method, so a get or a post, the response code, and whether it was success or failure. Essentially, very crude implementation here. But if the HTTP code was less than 400, it's a success. If I got an exception, I'll simply track that exception through App Insights. And then when I'm done, finally, I simply call the stop operation. So that sort of goes through automatically through every request. The way I've done that is with just by passing this entire function into my with request tracking function. So it's just a pipeline, essentially. And this is very similar if you've used Owen, where you basically write before and after the pipeline. So this code happens before. There's my next handler, essentially, and then there's the rest of the code. And I've done some trace listening, and which will basically just log every trace message. And finally, I've turned on something called dependency tracking as well, which essentially allows us to track dependent systems within my app, so HTTP SQL. And we'll see how that surfaces as well. The last thing I've done is hook into that event that I showed you in the F# script earlier, where I get a cache hit. So here I'm going to actually push that out into App Insights to say I got a cache hit. So the name of the cache and what the key was. So let's have a look at actually how that looks within the portal. So here's my App Insights pane. And if I go there, you'll see we see a number of things. So out of the box, we get things like server response time. So how does it know that? Well, every operation is timed. So it knows the individual response times for a particular server. And we can click into this and see, for example, every operation I've done based on the URL. So immediately now I get every URL sent through, how long it takes to process it. So this is super useful if you want to identify slow running endpoints in your app. And I can then click into that one and actually see the list of every hit for that particular operation. So it's almost like I can just continually drill down and see every call to this API. And then I can go even further and look at any individual request. So here you can see, for example, the time of the event, whether it was successful or not. I can click into it and get some more metadata about this event. So for example, I can get the IP address of where the request originated from, and so on and so forth. There you can see the device type, what continent it came from, IP address, all of these things out of the box for free. I'll find another request as well here, one which is maybe a bit more interesting. So let's look at this one. So this request actually had a number of different events happen within it. And what I can do is say, show me all available telemetry for this operation. What that will do is showing me not just this request, but any events and trace messages that happened as part of that actual request. So this is really useful if you've got, you know, a multiple number of hits per second on a website. You don't have to individually separate out requests one from another. App Insights does that for us. So you can see here we got the original request. It took 1.12 seconds, and we got three cache hits. But the fourth one actually had to go to the real website because that bit wasn't cached yet. And then I got the trace message as well that came from Suave. And I can look into that cache event and I can see, well, that was actually the results for your cache for August. So really, really easy to actually look at this sort of stuff. You also see this dependency here. So this is actually the call to Yahoo. App Insights has actually hooked into the app that I've written and actually traced that I've actually made a call to an HTTP endpoint and actually logged that as a dependency. So it actually understands that this is part of this operation. Now, if I look a bit further up, hopefully what we'll see is a page that I've made a request with a number of actual telemetry messages at once. Let me just quit. Let's load a few more. Let's try this one. So what's really useful is if you make a number of requests at once, it's sometimes useful to be able to see the relationship between them. So here you can see I actually made three requests to the Yahoo website as part of this single call. And I can actually view it as a timeline. So it actually shows me now graphically that I made three calls. They all started at the same time. So they happened in parallel. Two of them took half a second and one of them took 2 seconds. And I can obviously click into that to find out more about it. So immediately now I'm able to see a lot more about my application just with probably 50 lines of code, but by relying on a service that's already been created for us, i.e. App Insights. This sort of service would take you a long time to do manually, but we can do this out of the box. If I also look back at the dashboard, we'll see a number of other things here. So for example, failed requests we can see, the memory usage based on perfmon counters, all of those sorts of things we get. We even get exceptions. So you'll see before I had a page that it would automatically generate an exception. You can see here, here's the actual exception that's been raised. And I can drill into it, and it will show me the time it happened, if there were any others with the same exception. And I can even see things like the failed method that it occurred in, the exception message, and even the stack trace. So this has all been pulled out of of the essentially a simple amount of data that we're sending it, i.e. a couple of events, an exception, and some page load and end events. But from this, we can build up a real rich understanding of what our application's doing very, very quickly. Now, there was a question before about web jobs and how if we can use these alerts in the same way. So you can use alerts through App Insights as well. So for example, here, I can set up an alert rule based on any arbitrary metric I want. So I've got here failed requests, so on and so forth. You can create your own events within App Insights as well. They're just key value pairs. So there's nothing to stop you actually creating your own events here and then setting up a metric. So you can imagine here saying things like, if you've got customers reviewing a particular product on your site and giving it 1 star out of 5, if you get more than that in half an hour or something, send me an email or go to a web job. So you can almost have this separation of your internal data feeds and then how you handle particular events and use App Insights or Azure's portal as a mechanism for tracking what those hits are. It's also good just for simple searching as well. So we can do simple searches of every message we've got here, and you can see we get a graphical representation of them. So we've got 13 traces and 14 requests and so on. You can just see them down at the bottom, and I can filter on them as well. So you get a number of ready-made filters, but you can also just type in anything you want. So if I type in the text heading there, you'll see it filters out anything. And it will use more than just the message data here. It will look at all the metadata as well. So it's really useful. You can do things like metrics for rolling averages. So you could do things like, anything to do with your application internal metrics. How many rows did I insert into the database? Send that out as a metric. App Insights will automatically aggregate for that for you and show you that. So for example, here I can look at cache hits as an event, as a metric. So if I scroll down, we'll see that I've got my custom event there, cache hits. I've got 62 of them. I can also see that as a rolling at time. So if this graph shows up, you'll see we get the raw list of every event. And there we get a graphical representation of the events over a particular time window. So this is really useful where you can see any arbitrary metric you create, you can actually create a dashboard for it and then arbitrary alerts for. Just going to switch back to the application just to see if there's anything else I wanted to show you, really. I think that's pretty much it from an app point of view. You've already seen the App Insights code, and you've seen the football library. I guess what I'd like to do is just then wrap up by talking a little bit again about how I started with a pretty simple F# class library. It knows nothing about Azure, it knows nothing about websites, and I've managed to push it into a website with pretty much no effort at all. You know, 20 lines of code and we've got a hosted website. And then we've even gone a level further, and by using Azure, we've got an application that's scalable based on arbitrary metrics that we can track reports on, we can export data from, we can do alerts on. Out of the box by, again, delegating this to an app service, i.e. Azure Web Apps and App Insights to do a lot of the heavy lifting. So, you know, we use GitHub for our source control in this case, or Bitbucket. I'm using that to actually fire triggers into my app to do deployment. So I've got a CI process. I've got the deployment thought of. I've got resiliency because I've got load balanced websites. I can scale up and down based on traffic. And I've actually got a reporting endpoint as well based on errors at a high level, so HTTP server errors, and then application level through App Insights. So it's kind of an end-to-end sort of story here. And of course, we can export all the data from App Insights as well to an external store so that we can report on it offline, essentially. I think that pretty much wraps up what I was hoping to cover. I'm actually quite impressed with myself that I've actually done it in an hour. Usually I go well over talks. So I guess at this point, are there any questions?
I still don't see any questions on either Twitter or in the Q&A feature. If anybody has any, please feel free to post them. I did have a follow-up and this is probably more of a follow-up for a separate talk or something, but I was curious about Surface Fabric, because that seems like another opportunity to use F-sharp as well.
Yeah, so yeah, absolutely. So Service Fabric is really good as a microservice container. So it gives you this ability to have a cluster of machines, say 5 nodes, and then host a number of arbitrary services on them. And it will do things like load balancing automatically, and it will do things like stateful services with replicated state across those nodes. So if you imagine a microservice often needs its own small data store, you can use Service Fabric to do that out of the box. It's also quite good in that it works with arbitrary executables, but there is an SDK on top of it as well. So yeah, that would actually be probably quite a good talk. There are a few people using it, not just myself with F-sharp as well. And I think some people are considering looking at it as well as a Suave sort of hosting environment. I know there are a couple of proof of concepts on there. So that might be worth checking out as well.
Yeah, maybe we can have you on for a follow-up at some point.
Yeah, I'd love that. I'd love that.
Kunjan Dalal, and I apologize if I've butchered your name horribly, has asked, I needed to wrap F-sharp project and C-sharp project earlier. I haven't tried in your past. Is it not an issue anymore? I'm guessing he's referring to either the web site or a web job.
So you shouldn't have any problems with an F-sharp project in either of them. The only issue you have to be aware of, and this is normally on cloud services more of an issue, is that fsharp.core doesn't get deployed automatically. Most services won't have it out of the box. So you have to ensure that you actually have either set your fsharp core to copy local or use the NuGet package for fsharp core, and then it will get pushed out automatically. In terms of .NET and fsharp running as a web job or as a website or a cloud service, there's no problem at all with F-sharp at all. Like I said, the documentation may not be fantastic online. And if you look at the .NET story, it may push you down the road of C-sharp, but there's nothing to stop you doing F-sharp or hybrid F-sharp C-sharp apps at all.
Okay, and he clarified he was talking about websites.
Yeah, so websites, no, you can do so. The example I've got here is actually an F-sharp project. But actually what's happened is there's a GUID that's been added into it, into the project structure, that makes it look like a normal .NET web project. So if I do properties, you'll see we get the web panel and we get publish web and so on and so forth. You know, you can put a global ASX in there and it would get called just like you would with a normal C-sharp project. It's actually just a GUID. If you want to do something like this, I would recommend looking at that extension, those project templates I showed you earlier. Which basically will do a lot of that heavy lifting. Well, it's not even heavy lifting, but it will do it for you in a repeatable manner. So you can simply just say new F-sharp web project and you're good to go.
Okay, and his last question, F-sharp came to Docker and Azure supporting Docker out of the box. Have you tried that, or what is the story with respect to that?
So my understanding, I haven't tried Docker on Azure yet. My understanding of Docker at the moment is that it's Linux only. On Azure, I might be wrong there, but probably if John Azari is still on there, he might know a bit more because he does work for Microsoft. My understanding is it's Linux only at the moment. There shouldn't be any reason why you can't host mono applications within Docker. And there's also another service I believe out as well from Azure containers. And there's another containerized service coming out soon. But essentially, I think there's definitely, if there isn't now, there will definitely be a Docker story. I can't see there not being one for F-sharp on Windows. On Linux at the moment, I don't see why you can't do it already. It's just mono.
It looks like I see Christoph of Ionide fame wrote that there is now a blog post on the Docker website. It looks like it's pretty fresh about Docker on Windows. So maybe that's actually happening.
Great. So cool. So it might just be... The Docker service, if there is one on Azure, maybe doesn't yet support Docker on Windows yet, but it can't be long away. I can't imagine it'll be far off because, yeah, it's something I'd like to do as well.
Chris Garcia asks, in a situation where you have a reactive web app, say something that receives messages from a message queue and broadcasts them with SignalR, can that be hosted as a web app, or does it have to be a web job or worker app or Service Fabric app?
No, it can absolutely be a web app. The nice thing about the reactive side of the web jobs SDK is just a library. So all you essentially need in that is the web jobs SDK. It's a NuGet package. You add a couple of connection strings in your app config, and pretty much that's it. You create methods then on classes, or if you're in F#, you create methods on modules. You decorate them with an attribute, and that's basically it. You just say, I want to listen to a queue message. This is the name of the queue. And then there's a number of conventions for the actual content of the queue message, the retry count, all of that happens out of the box for you. Essentially, when the method ends, it will automatically complete the queue message. If it throws an exception, it will cancel the message. But there's nothing to stop you running that code in a cloud service, in a web app. You don't have to do it in a web job. I think it's just because it's called a web jobs SDK. It's got a, you know, people think it has. I'd almost rather it had just been called something like Azure.reactive data or something. It's really got nothing to do with web jobs as such, except the fact that web jobs will automatically start up a job whenever a queue message gets fired up.
All right, and that seems to be all the questions. Isaac, thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you for spending the time. I know it's evening for you, so thank you for cutting out a part of your evening for us.
Not at all. Happy to be here. And thanks again for inviting me. Any questions, anyone, please just catch me on Twitter or drop me an email. I'm always happy to help out with this sort of stuff.
And it's at Isaac_Abraham for those of you who didn't catch that earlier.
Yeah. That's correct. Yeah. I'll see if I can actually go back there quickly.
There you go. And F# Exchange is coming up. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, that's right. So if you're going to be in London, I believe it's the week of the 11th of April, so just 2 or 3 weeks away, Friday and Saturday. So I think the actual exchange is on the Friday, and then on the Saturday, there's also a hack day, completely free to go. There'll be loads of people there. I think Don Syme will be there as well, and a couple of other people. So yeah, it's looking like a really good lineup this year. Let me just go on to the side, actually. There's a Phil probably... bait me later. So yeah, here's the site, F# Exchange 2016. It's on the 15th of April, Friday. And there are a lot of really, Don Syme's doing the keynote, a load of really good people, Mark Seaman, Thomas Petrichek, Stefan Falkman from Germany will be there as well. So some really, really good talks there'll be. So yeah, please come along if you're about.
Outstanding. All right. Well, thank you again. We'll have the recording posted shortly for those who may have missed it. And again, if you catch it later, do reach out to Isaac if you have any additional follow-up questions.
Brilliant. Thanks a lot, guys. Bye-bye.
Thanks.